user is moving back and forth a lot while playing this Batman application, right? So really like going to the net to play a stop ball, going back and forth. So it uses a lot of space. In fact, it's 16 square meters, okay? Let's look at another user of our system. She's currently playing whack-a-mole and also uses a lot of space. An important fact here is that they share the same tracking body. And in fact, not only those two, but four users who share the same 16 square meters. All right. All the while, I think they're alone in the tracking body. So the Batman user plays alone, Batman users, all alone. Space Invaders, also, and Batman. So, why are we doing this? We think that the most expensive factor of our virtuality today is in fact not the technology, it is space. And there are two approaches to solve the problem. The first approach is to not use space at all, to just buy a treadmill. I have techniques such as walking in place or instant teleportation. And those techniques are great, but they're not as immersive as real walking. And real walking is basically the direct mapping between virtual, between physical and virtual motion. The second approach is to reduce space demand. There are a lot of space compression techniques, redirected walking being among the most popular. Basically change that motion mapping only unperceivably. So it's still like a real walking sensation, but you use less space. However, this applies only to lab scale VR, and not to consumer scale. So this is where virtual space comes in. Virtual space is a software system that overloads multiple users into the same physical space. And unlike other projects, this works for consumer scale. So we basically reduce the individual demand from 16 square meters to 4. How does the system work? In the beginning, we assign each application, each user, a tile. And we keep the user on the tile by placing rewards. For example, we play the shuttlecock always into that corner of the court. But after a while, users will feel confined. And this is why we move all users synchronously. So by placing a stop ball right in front of the net, or by moving the barrier in Space Invaders, place a ball somewhere else, or put a cherry somewhere else. And this happens now, and our users move. And we call this a maneuver, which is basically a synchronized movement of users in virtual space. This is not how we started. So and we wanted to users to share the same tracking volume, and what we started doing in the beginning was that we actually tried to prevent collisions. So we extrapolated the movement, had like some sort of prediction system, and which gave us like warnings of like imminent collisions, and then we placed an incentive, like a reward or an obstacle. And the problem is this is not very fast, so we can also be sure like some of it happened in 2 seconds, and that's not enough time to give a user a reward he or she notices. So instead, we orchestrate walking, and this is basically a more strategic approach. So virtual space does not prevent collisions actively, but orchestrates walking, and thus prevents collisions by design. Okay, this basically replaces our problem. So before we had the problem of detecting a collision, to prevent collisions, now we need to orchestrate movement. And how do we do that now? So this is the real-time output of the system. And as you can see, basically each user always has a tile which is assigned to the user. So, and we borrow from the concept of keyframes, so if like one keyframe, we want to get to the next keyframe somehow, and we just animate in between. And this way, the user has always some space to walk on. All right, and how do we keep the users? Basically, we add rewards. So play a shuttlecock, for example, here in badminton, or play some more in Wicked, or we remove obstacles. So we place a chair over there, goes is removed, base free user goes there. All right, this works great, but only for slow movements. What about fast movements? How about action sequences? And we also get it covered there. So imagine now the Batman user wants to engage in some sort of fast-paced rally. So basically wants to traverse all over the court. This would require more space. Basically the center of the tracking module. And then we need to basically move all other users out of the way. And our system does exactly that. And we call this a focus maneuver. So before we have seen the rotation maneuver, now we've seen the focus maneuver. So how do we decide which maneuver to perform? So basically we've seen the rotation and also the focus or defocus. There's also others like the stay maneuver, everybody stays in the assigned tiles. Or the switch, which is basically a rotation with two users. So we start by apps evaluating the space they might get. So let's say the Batman user is in front of the net, then the stay maneuver would let him like still be there. And we evaluate someone with some sort of number, let's say 25. Now if we want to have like another maneuver, this would lead to a different assigned tile, different space, which we could give a different rating. So for example, Batman wants already played a bunch of shuttles over there. Now we want to actually move the user, so we give this a higher valuation. And focus, of course, always good to have this kind of fast-paced rally, so give this some. So Batman is slightly different. So you can see all the pellets are somehow in the upper left area, not in the other areas. So this is where the Pac-Man app wants his user to go to. So we evaluate this with like even a higher number, say 120. So we have those valuations, and then we look at the maneuver history. So let's say we have a couple of rotations before, then a switch, and then a focus, and then look at the potential maneuvers to perform. So stay would give us an average value of 55, which is basically the value for the intended walking by the applications, and plus minus like a variance of say 18. Which is basically the fairness between apps. Rotation would lead to a high evaluation, average evaluation, and a focus even higher, maybe. But we have this trade-off. We kind of want to maximize the average value, but minimize the variance in order to achieve high intended walking and also like a high amount of fairness. And this is why, say, we pick the clockwise rotation. So, and now we just put that maneuver in a queue to be performed later. And this illustrates very well that how virtual space works. So it's like a software system that executes and plans in parallel. So the planning is done in parallel and the execution is done in parallel to achieve like a high interaction rate. So we decided on a maneuver, now the timing. So when evaluating, apps also give some sort of estimate how much time they need to perform that maneuver. So say Batman wants like 5 second preparation time, so it needs to wait for like a full ball exchange, for example. And then 1 second execution time for the user to actually go from point A to point B. Batman, say, needs 2 and 3 seconds. Great, now we have those values, also for the other two apps. And now we just pick the maximum preparation time and the maximum execution time, and there we go, 5 plus 3. So we can improve the interaction rate still. So we also have another option. Apps could give multiple possibilities. So let's say it's 3 plus 2 now. And then the maximum value decreases. And also we can just give a linear equation. So Pac-Man would say, well, I basically want this to happen within 5 seconds and I don't care about the preparation execution time. And then we give this to a linear solver and there we go. We have optimized interaction rate even further. So this is basically how virtual space works. Now we have implemented some optimization, which I want to share with you. So, first one, basically virtual space sees every app as a sort of rhythm app. So it wants to get them in sync somehow. There are certain moments in time where we can influence a user's movement. For example, with a badminton, every time the NMII hits the shuttle somewhere. So we have two badminton apps, then we sort of want to synchronize those movements, and this is what virtual space does in the background. And this basically decreases our preparation time a lot, thus increasing, again, detection rate. The second optimization is the initial placement. So badminton again. This, on the right side, you can see the spatial density distribution of 3 minutes of gameplay. And you can see here that basically what users want to somehow go back to the baseline, go to the center of the baseline, basically, because that's somehow the optimal position to be in. And so we go ahead and place the first badminton app, just put it in the room, and we place the second badminton app with a rotation offset of 180 degrees. So what we get there is like basically every app gets the tile it wants more often. And this is a good illustration of actually where the name comes from. So what virtual space does is basically how a memory management unit and operating system works. So instead of like having physical memory, we have physical space. And this is basically the concept of virtual memory, virtual space. So all of this results in an API, which is, so don't bother too much with all the function calls here, but this is basically the whole API which apps can implement. We implemented those four applications, actually also some more. And they all work in parallel. Right, and it's developed in a C# Unity. So we have two servers, one running virtual space, so deciding and timing maneuvers, and also tracking server, and this all gets streamed to our Samsung S6s, to be run in mobile VR. Alright, we performed a user study for this. So we had 16 participants split in four groups, and in each group we ran all four apps I've shown you. And two conditions. Basically, first we had like a static pre-allocation, so each user was assigned a tile. And in the second experimental condition, we moved those tiles around. So, and as you can see quite easily, this is basically 4 times 4 meters, our tracking volume. Virtual space lets users cover more space or use more physical space. When asked, participants also felt way less confined in the virtual space condition. So this is the average rating of some questionnaire. All right, so in summary, we developed virtual space, which is a space management system, which runs different apps and users in the same physical space and enables its users to share their physical space, and thus reducing the overall space demand to 4 square meters per user. This reduces the cost of real walking and can be seen as an alternative to related work, and actually also as a complement to other space compression techniques. In case you want to try it out, here's our GitHub link. Feel free to make a photo now or ask me later. Also, I want to especially thank my co-authors, Max, who is here somewhere. Max, where are you? This is the guy here. We met a lot here. And also, Patrick said he cannot be here today. He says hello. And that's it. Thanks a lot for your attention.
So.